Hey, wall crawlers, thanks for clicking on this special Spider-Man No Way Home spoiler cast that I recorded a few days ago with the indelible Henry Gilbert. He offered to allow both of us to host this 1 hour and 30 minutes of us marking out to this multiverse Marvel melee, and Jesus Uncle Ben Christ, we had a heck of a time doing it. If you wind up liking this particular conversation, hit the link in the description to check out the astounding variety of podcast episodes that Henry's involved with every single week. Absolute mad lad. Anyway, prime your web shooters and enjoy the show.
Hello, true believers, and welcome to this very special What a Cartoon podcast or Talking Simpsons podcast presentation. It's me, Henry Gilbert, not joined today by Bob Mackey. He's on vacation right now, but this episode, this special thing, it had to happen because I saw Spider-Man No Way Home. I have to talk about Spider-Man No Way Home after seeing it, and I knew the perfect person to talk to about that.
Where is he?
Oh, it's you. It's Matt McMuscles.
Oh, it's me. I thought another guy was coming. Hi, I'm Matt McMuscles. I'm going to say, how about calling it Slice O-O Spider-Man?
Yeah, I like
it. Slice of life.
That's good. This is a slice of Spidey. The listeners, long time to me, know that I used to talk about comic books a whole bunch, and I still cram it in whenever I can in the Simpsons and cartoon talk. But yeah, after seeing No Way Home, I thought I stayed up for like 2 hours talking about it with my husband, and then I was like, I have to talk to someone about this. And I was seeing Matt, you were tweeting so about it too. I was like, oh God, I bet he's up for this.
I bet he's got nothing to do. And at that particular moment, no, I was just, I think my tweet was, I'm still thinking about Spider-Man. And everyone's like, yeah, that's pretty much my entire life. Just thinking about Spidey.
I guess, you know, this is I will, you know, warn, this is a spoiler cast. If you haven't seen No Way Home yet, what are you doing? Like, don't listen to this. Like, this will spoil it for you.
We are unshackled by the choking chains of spoilers. Mm-hmm. So we can just talk about whatever.
But I really did like it. I thought it was it is like one of the most shameless fan servicey things I've ever seen, but that's what I love about it, honestly.
There's no way any group of creatives could have made, like, done this concept without it having, you know, like 30% of the movie is fan service, right? Mm-hmm. And I don't think anyone you can make like maybe a Batman movie without, because Batman's, you know, a little bit more serious, but Spidey is all about, you know, all these connections and all these crazy storylines, and like, it's, you know, it's lighthearted in nature, and I don't think there's any way to like properly do this concept without like having a nudge, nudge, and wink, wink, like, you know, every, you know, 20 minutes or so.
Yeah, I mean, once you've accepted that you're making what is essentially like Endgame, but for 20 years of Spider-Man movies, then just go all in on it. You know, why hold back then? If you're going so far as to do, again, hey, we're in spoiler town here, to go so far as to have all three live-action Spider-Man who have ever been in a movie all meeting each other and hanging out, and like, if you're gonna go that far, then set aside like 10 whole minutes sprinkled throughout it of just them talking to each other and comparing notes, like, hey, what happened in your movie? Well, this happened in my movie. What happened with you?
I mean that was the core conversation that happened. I went to go see it with like a my wife and my friend Liam and his girlfriend and everything, and our main takeaway was that this film makes all the previous ones slightly better, and in case of one of them, like, way better. And I'm sure we'll get to that in a second, but it was like, if we're going to do this, because I don't know about you, Henry, but like, I was assuming that all the other two live action Spideys would swing in the last 15 minutes, be like, hey kids, do like one move like per like villain, and a portal opens up and they leave.
Yeah.
So my big takeaway from this was like, wow, they went way harder with this than I ever thought they would, from a variety of standpoints, like contractually, how busy the other two actors were, even if they would even want to. And they show up and they're there for the entire third act. Like,
so they're long. They're in
there for like 40 minutes or more, you know? Maybe I'm being a little...
No. I looked at I somehow found a video file of a screen capture of the whole movie, and it magically appeared. But yeah, it was like, it seriously is 50 minutes from their appearance to the end of the movie. Like, they're in that much of it.
Whoa, that's awesome. Like, when they show up, the movie just flies, and like until the end of it. Like, not that the first part dragged or anything, because it's got a lot of moving parts. And do you know what's weird is that, okay, everyone, just not everyone, but like, you know, there's certain people that were like, I hope this isn't going to be a Spider-Man 3 where there's just way too much going on.
Mm-hmm.
And I was kind of waiting for the other shoe to drop at some point. I'm like, okay, this is, you know, the direct, like, you know, seconds later after Far From Home. I'm like, okay. And I just thought that, like, too much stuff would get thrown in there, but it really doesn't. There are moments I'm like, wow, they're, like, you know, spending a good amount of time with, like, this character here or Peter and MJ. And I just kept thinking, no, the next scene is going to be, like, way too fast and way too rushed. I never really got that sense at all. Like, there wasn't one particular bit where I'm like, oh, wait, slow down. And I read, like, never read like a full review, but I saw some headlines say like entertaining but overstuffed.
Mm-hmm.
And I couldn't get that out of my head, because, you know, you just have, like, you know, memories of Spider-Man 3 just dancing, literally dancing in your mind, dancing Toby. And I was just like, yeah, it's gonna start to break apart and fall apart at some point. And it never really did for me.
No. I think I've been thinking about just the length of superhero films for a while, because like very recently I've had cause to, because I thought Venom 2 was great for what it was. And part of that was that it was like, it's just 90 minutes. Like, this didn't have to stretch it a whole hour longer. But this is one of those 2.5 hour long ones that I think, you know, deserved it for how much they were gonna do and all the different things they wanted to do. Like, they needed to wrap up an entire trilogy worth of stuff for Tom Holland, but then but then also have a giant Spider-Man crossover, and they can't do a bad service to that. I also thought it was gonna be, when I saw the trailers, so I did remain unspoiled. I didn't even watch the last couple weeks of trailers, because my husband warned me, like, oh yeah, they have some secret stuff in here. But I knew they didn't reveal that Tobey Maguire, Andrew Garfield were in the movie, but I still was in my head thinking, like, they're probably in this. And I also figured, like, yeah, they'll be at the big Statue of Liberty fight. They just pop in, like, need a hand, buddy?
Yeah.
But then instead, like, no, they hang out with him for, like, so long, which is great. And I'm glad they had the time to do that. And that the actors, I didn't expect the actors to be around that long to be in the movie either, but they were.
Like, you know, if I can imagine, like, Marvel guys going up to them and saying, listen, you just have to be in front of a green screen for, like, you know, a few days, and that's your, you know, big action scene. But, like, no, they get, like, you know, just, like, they're just geeking out, making gadgets and shit, which was so fun, because it's something that doesn't happen. It happened a fair amount in Tom Holland movies, because he has the Arc Forge or whatever, Stark Tech, and, you know, makes things, costumes and whatever, little changes here and there to his suits and stuff. And I mean, it didn't really happen in Tobey Maguire movies that often, where he would tinker with his suit or do anything interesting in that regard. So it was really great. Like, if you're gonna have any scene of all three bonding and not fighting, them just inside a lab just being massive turbo nerds was exactly the scene it should have been.
Yeah. And it played on all their characters so well. Like, I guess, you know, before that, I did want to say too, I just loved all, I really did like seeing all the old actors for the villains too. Like, even I think Jamie Foxx was served so well by this movie. Like, he was so crappy that he was given a bad deal in his first movie as Electro. And then in this movie, he's like, no, let me just have fun and, like, let's just loosen up a little bit and I'm a cool guy. Like, you know?
It's probably one of the better representations of Electro I've seen, because Electro, not high up on, like, you know, my Spidey Rogues gallery, like, tier list. He's quite low. Like, I'll put Shocker above Electro, because Shocker's stupid.
Yeah.
Whereas Electro is also stupid, but he's not memes. Stupid.
Well, it's like Electro is like if Shocker got invited. invited to the Sinister Six, because like Electro can always be like, hey, I'm in the Sinister Six, so I'm a good villain, but he's equal to Shocker in like threat and powers.
He's like some type of like, you know, not very good wrestler in WCW, but then he gets to join the NWO for a bit and he's like, oh, people are actually paying attention to me. But yeah, this was like a cooler because I know they were trying to attempt an ultimate version of Electro, the Jamie Foxx thing, where he's like, you know, a weird blue energy guy, and this was just a nice combination of like a human dude, and he can get powered up so much that he's electrified and he's not so much concerned with like, you didn't come to my birthday, Peter. Yeah. And you know, that trope that got buried into the ground so fast, with a bunch of movies doing that with their villains. I wouldn't say he got the lion's share of like, you know, the character development or, you know, redeeming his character, but he certainly got more than, I mean, William Dafoe and Alfred Molina already awesome in their movies and stuff, but they get nice little things. I guess the only person that really got shortchanged is the Lizard. I think
nobody cares about him. Yeah.
I like the Lizard from a couple of, you know, conceptually, and you could probably do some interesting things with him. They didn't really do anything that interesting, not bad in the first Amazing Spider-Man movie, but here you could have easily replaced him with almost anybody. I don't know, say Shocker.
Yeah.
Just as a goof. To be fair, he is in Homecoming, but they have the shocking gauntlets. It's Donald Glover.
Oh, well, no, Donald Glover is buying them from the, there's two guys who are, there's two guys with Shocker gloves, and the one who's like Herman, he's the guy who, I just rewatched all the movies, so I have this little, in Homecoming, Vulture zaps.
Donald Glover is Prowler.
Yes, the Reese Ifrons or whatever, like he's kind of, I mean, he's like, Ifrons, He's as boring as he was before to me. I mean, that Lizard, there's a reason they leave the Lizard in the truck, because they're like, well, look, he doesn't need to be out here. Let's just...
Story-wise, they're like, well, you really don't need to be here. And also the CGI team really doesn't want to do you anymore.
Yeah, it's hard enough doing you in the big final fight scene. We can't have a big CGI. We already have the Sandman walking around in here. We don't need you also doing it.
Yeah, like, and Sandman's maybe a bit more complicated to make. I'm not sure, but... It was odd, was when he first started to speak, I was like, oh, right, yeah, the Lizard does speak when he's in lizard form, that's fine. But I swear when he talked, I'm like, oh, they didn't get that actor back.
Mm-hmm.
That's why he's in lizard form the entire time. Like, oh, he didn't want to come back, or you just couldn't, or whatever. So when he actually does transform back at the very end, I'm like, oh, he is there. Why did his voice sound so different?
Yeah.
It's strange.
It's weird. You know, you mentioned voices. That was something too. So after seeing the movie, that's when I watched a few like interviews that I didn't want to watch beforehand to have it spoiled. And in that, there was a clip of like Electro from the big final fight at Statue of Liberty, and Jamie Foxx had the like effect on his voice that he had in Amazing 2 with like his stupid like echoey thing on it, and that's when I realized like, oh, they removed that from before the movie, in between making that sizzle reel and putting out the movie. They're like, wait, this sounds dumb, take that out, like just let's hear his regular voice.
If we're talking about that last scene for a second, and you said you didn't watch the last couple of trailers, did you catch wind of the fact that they show the last scene of like three villains coming at and then you see only Tom in the trailer, but you see Lizard's head crack backwards, like someone's punching him, but no one's there?
I know. I did see that one, and that was the last trailer I watched, and that's when and the last preview footage, and that's when I thought, okay, wait, they edited some. After the Infinity War, the trailers for that just made up scenes. Like, I was pretty used to, I was starting to expect, like, okay, this trailer has made up stuff, though. Yeah, there was, like, multiple scenes in this movie that I thought, wait, that's different. Like, when Wong tells Wong in the movie actually agrees with Doctor Strange, like, yeah, you should fix it, instead of saying, hey, don't do that, I'm leaving, and then Doctor Strange gives him a silly cartoon wink. Like, that was such a joke moment in the trailer. That's not in the movie.
It isn't, but I was talking to a friend of mine that's actually done, like, trailers for, like, you know, smaller scale stuff, and they're like, you have to sometimes, to get the point of a story, like, across in a trailer, you sometimes will use, like, little bits that aren't necessarily accurate to that scene when you actually see it, but gets the information across a little quicker and more, you know, like, smoother to, like, you know, people that are just watching, like, 2 minutes. And I guess that's what that was. I'll never be more salty than the fact that an early footage and, like, a trailer and some promo shots of the Van Damme Street Fighter, there's a scene where he fights with a snake, like, kicks it and, like, grapples with it.
Oh,
and that's not in the movie, but it was filmed, but it was in preview footage. And I was like, oh, he's gonna Sonic Boom a snake. That's so cool.
Oh,
and then
man.
It never happens in the movie. I'm like, boo.
Man, I missed that. It always peeved me off when things wouldn't have the thing that was in the trailer in it. That actually was another of those moments that reminded me of in the second Wreck-It Ralph movie. Ralph destroys the internet, whatever. That was a dumb title. It should have just been called Wreck-It Ralph 2. But in the trailers for it, they had that scene of him playing a touchpad video game, but then it's not in the movie. And then in the movie, at the very end of the movie, there's a scene where a little girl is saying to her mom, "Mom, I'm sad when they don't have the scenes from the trailer in the movie," and then they play this scene in it. But the actors too, I mean, Alfred Molina, like, still great. He's always great, but
awesome.
And oh my God, like, Willem Dafoe, like, he steals this movie. I think he's the best part of this movie. Every scene he's in, I'm like, I love this guy. Once he smashes that goddamn garbage Green Goblin mask, he shows that, like, I could have been mask free the entire movie and just been the coolest villain ever, because Dafoe is the greatest, just the greatest actor.
And the movie I had watched, like, we only, by the time I was like, oh shit, we have to go see No Way Home, and we only had, like, one night the previous night to watch something, like, watch a Spider-Man to, like, just, you know, put us in the mood. So me and my wife watched, we were like, what do you want to, just Spider-Man 1, just the very first. We're like, okay. And then I didn't, like, of course I knew Green Goblin was in this, but I didn't know he would actually be positioned as the chief villain. I was like, oh, we made such a good choice.
Yeah.
And in the original, when he goes, I'm something of a scientist myself, we all, like, do what Marvel fans do, which is clap.
Yes, we do what we're told. Line. Yeah.
And then when he says it again, you just, yes, is that fan service? For sure. Does that only exist because of memes today? Absolutely. But it got such a pop from the crowd. If it gets a pop, then it wasn't a bad choice. So
yeah.
When John Watts just decided, yeah, I'm getting that shit in there. Like, that was absolutely the right choice, sir.
Yeah, you know, it's good to, I think a reason me and you both also really enjoyed it is, like, we like pro wrestling. We like pro wrestling style storytelling, and that is a lot of this, which is, like, you know, there's lots of types of movies, and there's this whole, if there's something I hate in film journalism right now, is that every time a director like Martin Scorsese is interviewed, they're like, hey, what do you think of Marvel movies? Like, well, stop asking these guys. Like, let them just make their own movies. What do you care? Like, but when he calls it a roller coaster, like, yeah, these are theme park rides, I thought, when I was in this theater watching this, I was like, I mean, yeah, this is a roller coaster ride of a movie that is, like, about fan pleasing me, but I'm having a good time. It's not failing at doing that. So
his roller coaster comment was never inaccurate. It was, like, I don't know, some sentences before that or after that, or, like, a separate quote, or he said something a bit, like, more, like, I don't know, old man yells at clouds. But, like, the actual roller coaster thing, I'm like, that's what they are. I mean, it depends on the franchise. I mean, there's certain movies where I'm like, I wouldn't really call them a roller coaster, but, like, this one certainly was. And while we're, like, kind of, like, talking about the general tone, like, roller coaster, whatever, I also felt, I'm not sure if you'll agree, but this is the most Spider-Man of the home series.
Oh, yeah, like, yeah.
This felt way less like a Marvel movie, and I think there's a couple of reasons for that. Not like Marvel, but, like, there was no Nick Fury. There was like, Tony Stark's never even mentioned by name other than, like, oh, my friend, someone said once. I think Happy Hogan. And that was basically it. And everything else was just very Spider-centric. Like, I get people that for Homecoming and Far From Home, where they're like, oh, he doesn't really spend a whole lot of time in New York. Like, even in Homecoming, like, he spends a lot of time, like, out in the boonies or whatever at that, like, you know, factory depot or whatever. And then there's, they go to that field trip, blah, blah, blah. And I kind of get that. And especially, you know, being in Europe, but, like, I don't necessarily want all three movies to always take place in New York. Like, again, comic book Spider-Man goes to different places sometimes. He's been to space.
Yeah.
You know, so I kind of understood this, but, like, this particular movie, you did get like a good smattering of New York, the Statue of Liberty, honestly. And he does, you know, go out to, like, again, the boonies a little bit when he finds Electro and Sandman. So there's just this great mix of everything. And since it was so Spidey-centric and all these villains, there was no way it was not going to feel like a Spider-Man movie. And again, you can point to Spider-Verse, you can point to Shattered Dimensions, the game. But to me, like, I don't know how specific this is to me, but I had a big bang of that one episode of the animated series where all the Spider-Men show up, and that, like, blew my mind in a different way than, like, Spider-Verse, because Spider-Verse feels like its own thing. The comic book versions feel like their own thing, but that was, like, such a special, like, specific little pocket. And this also kind of felt like that, but, like, in a good way. I would have loved to see some baller, rich asshole Spider-Man that has, like, the metal suit. That would
be cool. I love, that in the 94 series when he meets the other guy, like, wait, you got rich being Spider-Man? I'm poor all the time. Like, yeah.
He's like, how could you not get rich?
I feel you saying this. I agree that this feels like the Spider-Maniest of the MCU ones. I just recently watched all of them again. And so in Homecoming, it did kind of strike me of like, that Spider-Man spends like as much time swinging around Queens as he does like Delaware and Washington, D.C., you know, and it's just, but I think a choice they wanted to make was they just rebooted Spider-Man. Everybody has seen him swinging around New York so much. Let's do something different. Like, so I get that. And also the fact that any of these movies are good or great is impressive too, because like, it's not just like the Amazing Spider-Man movies. Those had, you know, Sony and to a degree Marvel with their demands. This had like Disney and Sony have to agree on every single part of this movie to make it happen. And it's like with that, with such powerful corporate masters, how you make anything entertaining is a miracle at times, I think.
When it comes, you know, if it's just a like a pure MCU movie like your Thor's or your Captain America's, it's like, doesn't, you know, not that hard, but yeah, exactly. When you have these corporate masters, I also don't know. Like, honestly, these movies should be worse.
Yes. You
know? They should be like the Amazing Spider-Man series, where there's these wild swings in tone and, like, you know, just very... one thing that to this day, even though it's been a long time since I've seen it, that just bothers me to no end. I know lots of other movies do this, and since you've watched them again recently, is the end of Amazing Spider-Man 1. They're so unsure that the audience will understand that a lizard gas will be released and will turn everyone into lizards. They're so not trusting of the audience that they have to have these massive computer screens that say like lizard gas being released soon.
Yeah.
And shows like little like animations of people turning into lizard, and it keeps going back to it and back to it. It's like, no, I understand. It's you gotta show the lightsaber falling down, you know?
Every time. Yeah, it's so little trust. Well, also it's like so little conviction of what they want. I just rewatched Amazing 2 in the last few months too, and that it was the first time I'd ever like put in the Blu-ray and watched the deleted scenes. And I was like, wow, the number of deleted scenes of this, like, oh, you didn't know what you wanted to do. Like, they're like, there's one major deleted scene. I'm like, actually, Peter should meet his dad and find out his dad faked his death. And then they went like, wait, what are we doing? And same with, you know, it's not on the Blu-ray. I wish it was, but they cast a Mary Jane for that universe. And they thought like, oh, she'll be in the movie. And then I think this was one of their better choices. They're like, wait, But no, we can't. If we want him Absolutely. To feel, we want him to feel bad about Gwen's death. We can't then just go like, oh, but here's your new girlfriend. So you got a new girl. What? Don't feel so bad, Spidey. Yeah.
Yeah, it's one of those things that they should have, like, that they didn't, that but they should have changed in Spider-Man 3. Is like, not that like her appearance wrecks the movie, but you could have easily taken Gwen Stacy out of Spider-Man 3, and it would only have improved it. Not yeah. like, you know, by a wide margin, but it would have been one less thing to mm-hmm. juggle. And like, the only reason she was there is like, give Eddie another reason to hate him. But he already broke Eddie's camera. That should have been enough for yeah. him to want to kill Spider-Man / Peter Parker. So Mary Jane being taken out of that film was probably one of their smarter choices. But everything else, from what I know, I don't know too much about the details about what was cut there. No, like, dad thing, but like, that should never have been. Well, maybe it could have been in a third movie, but you already had Goblin, you already had Electro, you didn't need like another thing on top of that.
You know, speaking of amazing, like, I think the most fun this movie has is making fun of Amazing Spider-Man. Like, Garfield's character gets he's the butt of most jokes. They dump on him. So like, even he goes like, yeah, you know, I didn't fight anybody. I'm not cool like you guys. And they,
I believe the line was, I'm lame. Yeah. I fought a rhinoceros machine.
Yeah.
That killed me. Just because I think any other actor, a lot of other actors, maybe if they had been in that role, like it wasn't Andrew Garfield, they might have been like, I don't really want to say that or whatever. But like, that made me, that his whole appearance in the movie, even more so than Toby, because Toby is somehow looked upon a little bit better, even though I find he's a weaker actor in most respects. Not trying to hate on the guy, it's just the way I feel. Not that Garfield was perfect, but as Spider-Man, he was like a really good Spider-Man. You can say, you know, maybe a little bit more uneven as Peter Parker, but he had all the jokes. And that was one thing about the Raimi trilogy, is that I can count maybe one or two times where Toby says like a Spider-Man like thing while being Spider-Man. And I believe it's when he swings a load of money back at Doc Ock and says, here's your change.
Yes. Yeah. That I remember that one. And I remember he, in number one, when Jameson says to him and Green Goblin, I knew you were in cahoots, and he webs his mouth shut and he's like, mommy and daddy are talking. Those are the two jokes I can remember that he says. Yeah, Spidey says.
Ironically, there's more in Spider-Man 3, but that's because he's being a dick to everyone, because that's what you do when you have the black suit on. Going back to No Way Home, like, I don't know if you had like any stupid like, oh, it'd be fun if like this dumb thing then happened. So in the climax on Statue of Liberty, when you see like the walls in reality breaking, you see like these vague energy forms coming out, and they're like looking around. It's people that apparently know he's Spider-Man and Peter Parker is one and the same. And there's like, why didn't Eric Foreman come out of the crack, because he didn't know. And I'm like, oh, it doesn't make any sense, but I really want Ursula to come out holding like a tray of cookies.
She's holding those cookies.
Do you have any
tray
moments where you're like, oh, this would be dumb, but I'd love this?
You know, I was kind of, I almost felt like I was in the movie, in that they were saying like, everybody who knows Peter Parker, Spider-Man in every multiverse, like, they mean us, the audience, we'll get pulled into. I kind of held out a little hope that any of the animated Spider-Verse people might appear, even like, you know, as those blobby forms in the ether at the very end. But I had seen beforehand Chris Miller, I believe, of Lord and Miller, that like said, no, Miles isn't in No Way Home. But I thought like, that's exactly what you would say if he was in No Way Home, isn't it? But yeah,
I'm pretty sure both Andrew Garfield and Tobey Maguire said, no, we're not in this.
Yeah, Andrew was the funniest, because he was doing Tobey Maguire, like, he doesn't do, seems almost like mostly retired. Like, this was like his big return to movies. But Andrew Garfield does lots of movies, and so he was doing tons of promotion for other movies. And of course, every question was like, but you're in Spider-Man, right? So he was the poor guy who had to be every interview like, no, I'm not, I promise. Nobody called me. No. he earned his paycheck. They better have paid him a lot of money just to like lie, just to be like a liar to journalists for 6 months, you know?
Because at this point you have to lie. Like you just have to say, I'm not in there, or I'm not aware, because it's the only thing you can say. If you're stuck with a microphone in your face or whatever, you can't just say like, oh, I can't comment on that. Like that's basically admitting that you're into the thing. But like, so it's the only gambit I have left. I just have, yeah, I'm not in that. But you lied. It's like, well, I didn't.
Yeah, it's to make the movie better. What do you want from me?
To make the movie better.
Especially when, I mean, the cheers in the crowd when he appeared, everybody, even I who was going into it thinking they almost certainly have to be in this movie, but right when they appeared I was like, I was glad they didn't just put it in an ad, you know, like that easily. And I'm sure starting on Monday, I bet the ads will roll out of like, the rumors are true. All Spider-Mans are in this movie, and they just start showing them in the trailers. But I liked to be surprised.
Yeah, I unfortunately did, you know, for months see like set pictures of them on the Statue of Liberty setting. Like, you know, just blurry pictures, and it's like, yeah, they could be fake. But then when I saw the Statue of Liberty setting in the trailer where they didn't show them, I was like, okay. I mean, it's my own fault, really, but at the same time, I'm like, eh. I was hoping for, having seen, and you said you liked it for what it was, but having seen me suffering through Venom Let There Be Carnage, its post-credit scene was unfortunately the only redeeming factor I found of that. And I kind of enjoyed Venom 1. Uh-huh. I did not enjoy Let There Be Carnage. And I'm like a, you know, pretty big Venom and Carnage fan. I just, that is, I should do a What Happened on that movie, because I actually think that movie needs way more stuff, because I think it was way too fast with no room to breathe anything. People just know where other people are at all times. There's so many lapses in like logic. Like it makes my mind spin. So when it shows that post-credit scene in Venom, I was like, oh, okay. All right, cool.
And then they just rip it away from you in No Way Home in their post-credits.
So that I can't be mad at a post-credit scene, you know? Like, it's not part of the movie's main narrative. Like, you know, I don't know any theories as to why they suddenly decided to pull back and let's not do that.
Oh, I mean, I assume that when they already had the film locked in, they're like, we can't really fit Venom into this, so let's just we can film two post-credit scenes that also say he is in this world, and then we'll just take him back. Like, that's to technically have Venom in this movie, because Venom is also now a billion-dollar film franchise, as insane as that is to say. So
my thing was that, like, we just want to keep these separate, or, you know, it's going to be really far out, but we want to at least hint and get ahead of trying to explain, do a whole origin story for a black suit thing. So here's a shortcut to that. Let's just drop a little, like, you know, symbiote egg, whatever you want to call it, spawn, and just let that be somewhere in Peter Parker's, you know, universe now. I'm fine with that. Yeah. I can't think of, like, why would Venom want to fight / kill Spider-Man? Because the whole, you know, raison d'etre for them to fight is like, I hate you for this reason. Like, Eddie Brock's already like a loser that lives in an apartment alone, doesn't have anything going on.
Peter hasn't ruined his life at all. Yeah.
Yeah. What am I supposed to do? Get you kicked out of your apartment? Like, you know, I can understand them going, oh, okay, how are you going to do this? And like, you know, maybe do something else. I would love, maybe not in the next film or whatever, but I would love for them to eventually come back around to a black suit saga, but do it more in the sense of he has an entire movie in the black suit. And like, I you know, there's interesting things you can do there. There's other black suit storylines that have happened in the last like 20 years that don't necessarily even have Venom in there. And I would like to see where that goes, because I'm definitely sick. Not that Defoe made me sick, but I don't need to see a new Goblin storyline. No. I know there was an interview recently with Tom Holland where he said, oh, Timothy Chalamet would make a great Harry Osborn. And I said, Yeah, he probably would. I don't want that to be the case.
No.
I'm done with Harry, you know?
Yeah, I'd rather just I was pitching out with my husband too, like, well, where do you go? Like, what hasn't been explored as much? And a big one, especially like, spoilers, I guess, for the Hawkeye show, if you're not watching that, and we're recording this before the last episode of that, but like, Kingpin is fair game now in the MCU. Mm-hmm. Kingpin exists, and I was just thinking, like, Spider-Man has all of these mafia villains, starting with the Kingpin, but there's, you know, Kingpin, Rose, Hammerhead, Tombstone.
Rose. Damn, and, what a cut.
And Hobgoblin fits in there, too. Like, Hobgoblin is, you know, I could totally see a Hobgoblin being created out of this, who, like, saw that Green Goblin tech, and he's like, what if a not crazy guy had this and tried to take over the underworld with it? Like,
I think for the first new film of like a Tom Holland thing, because it's obviously kicking off a, you know, different phase that I would like to think is going to be way less insane. Mm-hmm. No dimension hopping stuff. I mean, that's just my general feeling. Like, you can't do it again. So you start off a little bit like slower and maybe have like a movie that's more street level. I would love for Kingpin to be in there, because when you really think about it, not like a lot of mainstream fans may associate Kingpin with Spider-Man that much.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, anyone that like has been into the character for the last, you know, 30 years, say, he's been in almost every Spider-Man thing. Plenty in the comics, lots in the animated series, in almost every video game. Like, he usually has a spot almost everywhere.
Yeah, and that in the mega successful PlayStation exclusive, like, he is a huge part of that game.
Like, kind of his absence kicks off. You know, he gets sent to jail, and he's like, this is going to ruin the city because there's going to be a power vacuum. And it happens.
Yeah, yeah.
I would like to see a street level movie, maybe with Kingpin. I saw some people throw on Black Cat.
Yeah.
I think that's a fine direction to go in, because you can bring in another girl that he could strike up a relationship while still having Mary Jane in the background. And that would eventually, maybe over one, two movies, can kind of develop. And throw that was a big I still don't know at all. And got another huge pop from the crowd.
Yes.
Was Charlie Cox returning to be in a very short scene as Daredevil, but that I think that was slightly louder than Toby and Garfield showing up.
That was so, yeah, in my theater, the cheers for Toby and Andrew were like, okay, they are here. Oh, yeah. Oh, because the way it's paced out, like, it's Andrew first. And then once you go, like, oh, like, this was the buzz in the audience. They're like, oh, my God, this is Andrew. That means he's here. Then Toby is here, too. And you're just kind of waiting. That's why it's great. I think they did pace that really well. Andrew comes out, and he's in full Spider-Man costume. So he has to unmask to make you go, like, yep, it really is him. But once you see him, you know Toby will be here. So that's why it's fine for him to just show up in regular Peter Parker costume and be like, oh, yeah, hey, it's me, I'm Peter, hi. And the way Ned calls him, like, oh, it's just a regular guy, like, yeah.
but Daredevil showing up, having, like, you know, a few seconds, like a minute or two, but that was just enough. That's all you really need. And then that just obviously opens up the doors easily, even if Kingpin didn't show up in a Hawkeye. Here's Netflix Daredevil.
Yeah.
Therefore, Netflix Punisher exists. Mm-hmm. And I know Tom Holland and Jon Bernthal are like,
oh yeah, they're bros,
best buddies.
Yeah,
they were in a movie together like a few years back before they're really kicking off with Marvel stuff. And I know that they're like, you know, they pile around whatever. Oh.
Yeah,
I would kill for Punisher showing up in a Spider-Man, in a darker, like, street level Spidey movie. You throw Punisher in there, I'd mark out.
Well, as hardcore Spider-Man fans, like, we know Punisher started out as he's a Spider-Man spin-off character, you know, he became his own guy, but he started off as a spider guy. So yeah,
that's a lot of people forget that, even I forget that, and I own that issue. The one comic I own that's like worth anything. Big ups to my friend Rocky for getting that for me for like a birthday present.
Oh, that's nice.
Was like I'd have to look back and find an interview, or maybe you might even be aware, but it's like, how did he even get out of being a Spider-Man? Like, was the reaction to his initial Spider-Man, like, comic book appearance, like, that positive that Marvel was just like, oh yeah, maybe we can, you know, make this character do other stuff and be here, be that? Because lots of Spider-Man villains did not make it out of Spider-Man dungeon, you know?
Oh yeah, like, I think for Punisher, he just slowly grew over time. Like, he made a first appearance and he was just like, he essentially was just an assassin type dude, you know, like, he's just one of a million different assassins. Like, I think it was his costume at first was just so memorable, and then as he kept appearing, then came in all of this character stuff for him, and then they, you know, in the 80s, I think it was just this perfect fit of, like, people wanted it. It worked. I actually think the big takeoff was that Frank Miller really liked that character and made Punisher look really cool in his Daredevil run, and I think that was the final, like, extra step to Punisher being a big a solo deal.
Yeah, okay, that makes sense.
But yeah, I love
that. Would be awesome to get him in there. Like, I don't mean like have like a team up movie or anything, but you always want to be. I'm currently playing through Spider-Man Web of Shadows, and a fault of that game is that it's barely a Spider-Man game, because there's like every hero and villain show up to be like a controllable, like, NPC, not controllable, but like, they show them that you can call them in to help you, and they're constant quest givers, and like, Spider-Man doesn't really have a lot of urgency in that game.
Yeah.
So I would never want that's why I assume a lot of people were like, oh, I hate how Iron Man is so ingrained in these movies. I get that to a point. I did not have a problem with it in Far From Home, because I think it was done like pretty minimally there. There's like, you know, like a little bit, but the character just died. So I think that's fair. And in this one, I was glad they did push it in the back, like way, way, way into the back, where it's just like a hint of it. But you always have to be, well, it's really fun to see these characters cross over every so often. And that was another thing I was worried about this, is that like, how much is Doctor Strange going to be in it? I love Cumberbatch as Doctor Strange. And it was just like the perfect amount, where he's there for the setup, has a quick, you know, Doctor Strange-y fight, then shows up at the end to do his function. Like, it wasn't like he was there, but he was there for his purpose. It wasn't just there to be like, hey, I'm here, just, you know, do it. Like, it didn't feel superfluous to me.
Yeah, you know, the Daredevil scene and the Matt Murdock scene and the Doctor Strange stuff both reminded me of stuff I enjoy in the comics, and it really did feel like, oh, this is taking the spirit of the comics into the movies in ways I enjoy from Marvel movies. And because in the Spider-Man comics, many times it's like, uh-oh, Spider-Man needs a lawyer. Well, Matt Murdock is his lawyer. Like, he always turns
he's
to
literally
him.
The only lawyer in New York.
And so I love that aspect of it, that they put that in there. And also, I just love a Daredevil Spider-Man team up. Like, that's always fun for me. But then with Strange and Spider-Man, you know, they're both Ditko creations. Them hanging out is always fun. I also just love, in all the Marvel movies, the Doctor Strange's solo movie is my least remembered thing Doctor Strange did in any of the movies, because he's so, I much prefer him as just the guy you go to of like, ah, crap, a magic thing. Well, better go ask him. Like, he'll figure it out. Like, Doctor Strange knows what to do.
I love the amount of talking shit about magic throughout this movie. Everyone's like, magic, what? Like, oh, you're like, you go to birthday parties? And everyone's like, what are you, magic? What are you talking about? It's science, baby.
Everybody just goes like, well, magic's real, huh? Well, okay. Yeah, like, that MJ just has to say like, yeah, but magic's real. You're in a wizard's prison. Like, I just gotta, let's cut to the chase, guys. Like, I just
literally a dungeon of a wizard.
I, you know, so in Venture Brothers, they have their parody Dr. Orpheus character, and it's one of my all-time favorite commentaries on Dr. Strange as he's used in most comic books. Because in the episode from season 2, Revenge of the House of Mummies part 2, they are stuck in a death trap and they're like, how do we get out of this? And a character, Hank, just says, we should call Dr. O. He's magic. And that's just what everybody says in the world. They're like, oh, the Fantastic Four have like the devils bothering them. Well, we better, Mephisto. They're like, well, better call Dr. Strange. He's magic. He knows how to do this. Like,
I remember one of the most early, like, internet complaints when Mortal Kombat versus DC was announced, the video game. And everyone's like, what the hell? Why? How can Kano beat Superman? And then I think Ed Boon or whoever at Warner Bros. Would just say, literally just go, it's magic.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Superman is weak to magic. Like, anyone can do a magic thing and it affects Superman. And I'm sure, like, you know, prime DC geeks would be like, yeah, yeah, of course, that makes sense. Yeah, the issue, whatever, you know, blah, 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 page three. And then most mainstream people be like, what? That's bullshit. That's not true.
if you literally say it's magic, you're like, yeah, that's not an excuse. Saying it's magic is not an excuse. Yeah.
I get really mad when people say that, but I'm like, I can't dispute it. You're right.
But yeah, Doctor Strange was in this just the right amount. Like, he kind of saves the day in the very end, or just, he does do the magic trick that, so when I went in this movie, I did hope that you don't want a cosmic reset button to mean nothing ever happened. And because then you're asking yourself, why'd I watch a movie if nothing happened? But I didn't want at the end of this movie that Peter Parker didn't have a secret identity anymore. Like, I really, they showed what happens if Peter Parker loses his secret identity. As they say in the movie, like, multiple times, I'm the most famous person on Earth now. Everybody knows me. I'm just super famous. And you completely lose who Peter Parker is if he's a very famous person, you know?
I mean, that's why it's a thing in the comics with when he reveals his identity in Civil War. You know, that's pretty fun and novel for, like, a little while, but then it's like, yeah, it loses the character, really. Mm-hmm. So I'm really glad with what they did, where it's like he did lose something. There were stakes, and he loses, like, a best friend and a girlfriend, and, you know, obviously, like, Aunt May as well. So I'm really glad they did that, because at the start of the movie, in the middle, when it's like, oh, I'm famous, everyone's crowding around him, and it's like, oh, Mysterio, like, I did actually get sick of that.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
As a framing device and, like, things in the background happening, I'm like, yeah, I can't take multiple movies of this. So because, you know, there wasn't any resolution to the Mysterio thing, which I don't think there needed to be. Mm-hmm. But it did make me, I don't know how you land on this, but it's like, I've been thinking about it, like, recently, especially when I was replaying some Spider-Man games and Mysterio's included. It's like, holy shit, I really, really liked Jake Gyllenhaal's Mysterio and how he actually did affect, you know, a hero in a, like, very concrete way that, like, spilled over into another movie and set up, like, a whole other thing. Like, yeah. That's usually, you know, the Joker dies at the end, you know, so-and-so gets defeated, blah, blah, blah. And they get sent to, you know, whatever super-powered criminal, like, prison that there is. And that's usually the end of it. So it was refreshing to see them carry that over. And that spun to the next movie in an organic way.
And it picks up, like, immediately afterwards. Yeah.
Immediately. Like, it's always weird when that happens, because it's a 50-50 shot whether the movie will suffer for it, like, I don't know, Mortal Kombat Annihilation,
yes,
where they do that exact thing and it just, it ruins the film, or you do it in a way where it does actually kind of feel like a two-parter.
Mm-hmm. You know, yeah,
in and of itself, like, they didn't write it to be so, but they had at least an idea of what they're going to do.
I mean, yeah, they I think they accepted, like, oh, if we're going to end the movie with Spider-Man has no more secret identity, then you do have to just pick right up, like, okay, what immediately happens after that? Like, I guess they could have just said 6 months later and then just characters say, well, that happened, but now we got out of the legal trouble. They had to say, like, well, okay, well, once his secret identity is revealed, he will be arrested and the police will have questions. Like, yeah. Which I do love MJ as a character, her saying, like, don't talk to the cops, talk to your, like, I want a lawyer, I don't talk to cops. Like, that was fun. But you're right, like, Mysterio, I mean, in real life, things like Mysterio's conspiracy theory don't get resolved. They just continue on, and some people believe it and some people don't, you know?
Okay, this is where it broke down with my friends where we had a conversation. I'm like, so everyone doesn't remember Peter Parker, but wouldn't the bit of Spider-Man having killed Mysterio still live on in everyone's minds?
I would guess people remember that Mysterio, yeah, I guess they just remember that Spider-Man fought Mysterio. Everything Spider-Man did, people remember that Spider-Man did that. They just don't remember. Well, I guess to me, I'm also... I am grafting on some of how this was explained in the comic books when a similar thing happened after Civil War, when Spider-Man gave away his marriage to Mephisto and reset his secret identity. And in that, basically it was every place that it would have, even in like computers in all throughout the universe, it was erased that Spider-Man was Peter Parker, and people who everybody that used to know simply forgot. And in some cases they knew they forgot, like Johnny Storm on the Fantastic Four is like, I knew who you were and I don't now. You must have done something and I kind of don't trust you now. But so I'm wondering if that's how it would be, like that after this Doctor Strange will remember me and Spider-Man, because J. Jonah Jameson does say, oh, Spider-Man had a fight at the, after it happens, he goes like, Spider-Man had a fight at the Statue of Liberty. So he does know that happened. So I wonder if even Doctor Strange is like, yeah, I did this with Spider-Man. He's somebody, I don't know. I never knew Spider-Man's secret identity. The end. Like, yeah, I want it, because...
Yeah, it's a complex theoretical, you know, galaxy shredding question, you really think about it. But it was still a lot better than, you know, you could, like almost any other movie would be like just time travel. Mm-hmm. Just you go back in the past, erase the mistake, whatever. So, but that, you know, gives a whole other bunch of like, you know, plot inconsistencies and blah, 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 blah. And yeah, I don't have the time stone. So the fact that it's just forget, it was just a little bit of an inspired choice, because it makes it a lot more cleaner. Like, yeah, we can get into the minutia of it and pick it apart, but it makes more sense, and at least still has those stakes there of like, you know, people forgetting who he is, like the people close to him. So it was a very interesting way to set up the next movie, and I like how they didn't. I mean, the Venom symbiote thing was like a little, that's leaned into a bit more, but I love how open it was, but also it felt like a definitive kind of end to this like home series arc. Like, they could not do another one for a bunch of years, and I'd be generally pretty happy. It's not like, oh, I want to see what happens next, but I was just shocked at how well the whole ending was like handled.
Yeah, you know. Okay, so yeah, I want to talk about that new status quo at the ending too, because another reason I wanted to do this is to reply to people on Twitter. But but also because I don't want to say this on Twitter, because I'm trying to be like no spoilers at all on Twitter. But so This is not me trying to brag, but I had a kind of viral tweet that last week about what I didn't. Something, and I like the Tom Holland Spider-Man movies, but especially in Far From Home, I didn't like that he was like James Bond and that he got a $1 trillion drone program from Tony Stark, and that when he rebuilds his new Spider-Man costume at the end of the movie, he's like, yeah, just give me all Tony Stark stuff. Boop, boop, boop. I can build whatever I want. Like all that. Mm-hmm. I just didn't like him inheriting. He didn't get rich directly from Tony Stark, but he did get just all this stuff from Tony Stark. And the point of the movie is to say like, he's the new Iron Man. Like that's, so that was my big complaint. And then even in this movie, this is such a Spider-Man-y movie. I'm not saying it's a away from the core of what Spider-Man is, but for Tom Holland's Peter Parker in the movie, he is a very famous person the whole movie, and he's not really doing Peter Parker-y things. So then at the end of the movie, the last 5 minutes, like the reset of everything, and he's lost it all, and he's in a cheap apartment, and he can't go to college, and he's taking a GED because technically he never existed and he didn't graduate high school. All of that that puts him back to where classic Spider-Man is for me. You know, Peter Parker's been many things in many different comic books and cartoons and movies and all that, but to me, my favorite version of Spider-Man is the Peter Parker mostly that's in Spider-Man 2, who is a poor guy who is like, I gotta pay for rent and web fluid, and J. Jonah Jameson's not gonna buy my photographs. Oh man, like that's, and this is what that ending felt like to me. And so when I complained about that on Twitter, then I was seeing people now, since the movie's out, quote tweet me like, oh, this aged well. And that pisses me off, because I'm like, no, I was right. The end of the movie is agreeing with me that they're like, they're going back to the status quo. They like, it's not proving me wrong, it's proving me right, because the last 5 minutes is going back to what I said is the best version of Spider-Man. But anyway, that was a whole like sorry man, that was just a rant I wanted to go on there.
But no, absolutely, you deserve that, but you deserve to get that bit out there. But you're saying that you love that particular phase of his life, Peter Parker, and like I have a lot of memories reading comics and, you know, watching the cartoons in the 90s of that. What kind of made me get a distaste for that was kind of Spider-Man 2, because that's mostly Spider-Man 1 as well, but Spider-Man 2 obviously more. He's doing all the odd jobs, pizza, whatever, and maybe it's just the way he likes to direct, but Sam Raimi goes way, way too far showing how down on his luck he is. People are offering him like hors d'oeuvres at a party and then they get snatched away. Like, it drove it way too. I'm like, okay, this guy is such a loser. I'm good now.
No, there's
hammered it home. I want him to be successful at some point. Maybe getting Iron Man tech and like that's way too far in the other direction. I agree, because I was reading Spider-Man the most, like 91 to 93, like every issue of Amazing for sure. If I could get my hands on anything else, Web, Spectacular, whatever. And it's like that, he was like right in the middle. You know, I'm full time at the Daily Bugle. You know, I have this gorgeous, buxom wife that we still have never gotten that Spider-Man, you know?
Yeah, like, yeah.
We've always started off with the girlfriends and whatever, and then him and Mary Jane's relationship in the Raimi movies gets so toxic. It's like, I don't even think you guys should be together, honestly.
No.
and the Mary Jane stuff in the Tom Holland movies is just starting again. So it would be really cool to maybe not even with Tom Holland, but maybe like, you know, way, way in the future. I don't know. I'm going to be like my 60s by then. I would love that 90s Spider-Man where he's just in the middle. Like, he's not like this loser that can't hold a job, but he's also not like a new Iron Man. And we haven't quite got that yet. I thought we would eventually get there with Andrew Garfield, but that was obviously cut a bit short. But I mean, you're right that it got all reset at the end, though, because I do want to see that Spider-Man again now, because
yes, we had
three Tom Holland movies where he's like, you know, pretty well taken care of and he's not really struggling. So it would be, it is exciting to me to see, especially since he gets a new costume at the very end of that last 5 minutes.
No, I
get to see it, but
I'm waiting for the, like, yeah, this made me feel like such a like Marvel simp after the movie, but I was saying like, I want to see a toy of that new costume right now. There's not a real hero shot of that costume. They keep having the lights go on and off it, so you can't get a real like straight ahead, here's what the costume looks like, even though they fully designed a costume. I'm sure there's, you know, digital stills we could see of it, but that is the quality of all three of the Holland movies, I think, is that each of them ends with a thing that makes me go like, well, I want to see the next one now. Why is the next one tomorrow? But though I think the one reason I'm holding back my hope of like, oh, this tells me what the next Spider-Man movie will be like, and it's back to basics. He doesn't have any Stark tech, he makes his own suit, he doesn't know any rich guys, and he can't call the Avengers for help, all that stuff. That's what it makes me think. But Sony especially, this ending really reminded me of, did you watch many of the Daniel Craig Bond movies?
I watched all of them.
So at the end of Skyfall, which that whole movie is about him going like, can I still be James Bond? Am I James Bond?
Yeah.
Then at the end of that, they're like, he decides like, no, I am James Bond, and it's the James Bond status quo. I got Money Penny, I got M, I'm James Bond. And then the very next movie, they're like, nah, he's not James Bond anymore. None of that James Bond, he quits. Like, it's so, I feel like Sony likes to end, and that was a Sony movie too. I feel like in the Bond movies, they multiple times ended with, and the status quo is finally here, you've been waiting this whole time. And then the next movie, they're like, nah, status quo is boring, let's blow it up again, you know?
Hell, even the start of Skyfall is like, oh, I'm not James Bond anymore, I'm just gonna retire to like Jamaica or whatever, I'm just gonna hang out here. Oh no, a thing brings me back.
Yes.
And then what you're saying happens, yeah, again at the end of that movie, and then towards the start of Spectre, and they still kind of do it in No Time to Die. They still have a scene where he's like, oh, I'm not James Bond anymore. But like, I do, like, you have to have at least one, especially towards the end. But like, Skyfall was the middle, but Daniel Craig always made it seem like, I'm not going to return for another one.
He's the flakiest Bond, he really was.
But you know, not to get into like James Bond podcast, but like, I think out of all of them, I think he did the best and gave like the most effort in No Time to Die, because it was like for sure this last one. But he was excellent in that overall. Like, he's,
yeah.
I thought he was just the most animated, seemed like the most passionate during it. So that was cool. But you're right that modern Sony Pictures seems to like be hanging on to their Pictures division because at any moment Disney can just buy them.
Yeah.
Because yes. I think that was like a rumor a few months ago. It's like Disney's just like, let's just buy Sony Pictures. Let's just be done with it, you know?
And when I could see a day that like the overall Sony company just goes like, why do we own a Hollywood studios anymore anyway? Let's just spin it off and sell it to whoever. And then of course Disney's got the most money and they buy it. Like, yeah, I could. Well, that'd be pretty funny if Warner could outbid them and then Warner owned the rights to Spider-Man movies. That would be pretty funny. But
it would be crazy. That would be multiverse ending shit right there.
But you know, okay, so there was a couple other little things I wanted to mention that I liked about the movie. First off, I want to say, like, my husband, he's Filipino, and he really loved that the most important, like, the scene where Toby and Andrew Garfield show up is in Ned's home, and it's about his Filipino family, and like, the grandmother is speaking Tagalog the entire scene, which he was laughing extra hard in it because he understood every word she was saying in that, and I was so he didn't need Ned's translation, which that was really fun. I liked that. Oh, and yeah, I also like that. Okay, I love crapping on the amazing movies, and that's why I liked how many times this movie made fun of the amazing movies. They were like, yeah, I fell into a vat of eels. They had that eel joke so many times of like, yeah, it's pretty stupid. You just got powers from a bunch of eels in a vat. Yeah. But
I think the second time they make it, I was like, yeah, okay. But then when they made it of like a third time, kind of, I laughed harder the third time.
Yeah, and same with like too, that they even dealt with the thing, the entire Donald Glover of it all, of like having Electro say to him, like, you know, I knew all of this about you. You're from Queens. You help poor people. I just thought you were black. And then Andrew Garfield just goes like, no, I'm sorry, man. And he goes like, I got to.
There's gotta be a black Spider-Man out there.
Yeah, I just love that. Like, again, it's all Andrew Garfield going, like, having to deal with the entire thing about his original casting. Like, the reason Donald Glover went so viral was people saying on Twitter, you know, hey, shouldn't it be like Donald Glover? He'd be great for this. Why does Spider-Man have to be white? And that started a whole conversation that a bunch of assholes didn't like. But
of course,
it was fun. It was pretty funny that they put a bow on it with even him going like, I'm sorry, man. I shouldn't even been cast in this. I'm sorry.
He just doesn't want to disappoint anybody, Andrew Garfield. He's just like, oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah, he's like the most cringy of like, guys, I love you. And they're like, yeah, it's cool. Thanks. Yeah. And then Toby's Peter feels like so much more normal and like chill. Like, he's just dealt with it. Like, but Garfield never got his third movie, so he has all this incomplete character stuff. So once he finally catches her, he's like, oh my, when he catches MJ, he's like, my character is complete now. I finally.
Yeah. I've seen a few people, and one of my friends was like, me as well, like a kind, like, you know, misty eyed, I think, at the very least, because out of all the faults of the Amazing Spider-Man movies, like, I love their relationship. I think it was so, like, refreshing compared to how most of the Sam Raimi movies, MJ and Peter don't even seem to like each other that much. I think all three couples all dated at some point.
Yes, the actual actors, yes.
Which is crazy because it seemed to me like Toby and Kristen did not like each other at all during any, like, in any multiverse or whatever. But so when Andrew got to have that little bit with MJ in this movie, catching her, like, I was just like, oh, they really didn't even need to do that. But they kind of knew that was a mistake, or at least poorly handled how that was done in Amazing Spider-Man 2, where it's like people did not walk out of that feeling like pretty good at all.
No.
Or whatever. But sometimes I'll flip flop on that, like, oh, that was pretty bold, I'll give you that. I never would have thought you would have done that does it make for, you know, a feel-good superhero movie? Not really, especially, you know, Spider-Man, but...
The way her head cracks open is just so intense, like, in that movie. Like, yeah, her... Oof.
It's one thing if she just splatted on the ground, he's just too late or something, but the fact that he's, like, he kind of kills her inadvertently was always, like, you know, people... That didn't sit right with people, I think, at the time, if my memory serves.
Yeah, yeah. There are probably a lot of other Easter eggs I didn't catch, but there was one super inside Easter egg that I really loved. So, do you remember from there were many funny emails that came out of that Sony hack that happened with relation to North Korea? And there were so many funny, like, these were internal notes about how to make the Amazing Spider-Man films that make, I think that also made the Amazing Spider-Man films look like even shittier, because you could see people like Kevin Feige saying, no, don't do this thing that's in the movie, like, this is bad, and they did it anyway. Mm-hmm. But so no. One of my favorite things in it is that they have all these suggestions, like, you know, Peter Parker should do what young people do today. He should do EDM, and he should say NBD, meaning no big deal, because that's what the kids say today. And I thought that was the stupidest thing in the world. And so in the movie, when Andrew Garfield Spider-Man says, oh, I have already cured the lizard anyway, I can just make that no big deal, and they're like, he's like, yeah, no big deal, and he just walks. I love that. It was so very inside, but I love that he finally said no big deal.
Oh yeah, Christ, I forgot.
I laughed. That my husband said that's the loudest I laughed in the movie, was hearing that.
A lot of that still kind of, well, not a lot of it, but like some of that sneaked into the movie, into the Amazing Spirit series, where he's like, look, he's a skater kid who like is into photography and whatever. He would not be picked on.
Yes.
Like in that setting, you know, even in the Raimi movies. The Raimi movies are weird because it's like, here's this weird nerd from the 70s, but he's in the 2000s.
Yes.
Like, you know, I think time has changed, but like, you know, Sam Raimi loves his 60s and 70s Spider-Mans, like kind of his introduction to the character. So I can understand still wanting to bring that in, but doing the nerd Peter Parker thing was always weird to me in this, like, you know, even the last 20 years. So when they didn't really do that, where Peter's already in a school of nerds, I'm like, awesome.
Uh-huh.
I don't have to go through that. We've gone through it twice already. Just like with the his origins and Uncle Ben and all that. Still so happy they skipped all that stuff.
Tom Holland gets bullied by other nerds. Is like basically the Flash is just also a nerd now, except Flash is rich. You know, that's.
I didn't know. Watching Sam Raimi Spider-Man 1 again, that Joe Montana
Manganiello, whatever, I completely forgot. Yes, yes.
That blew my mind. My wife's like, isn't that the guy that's he grew into like this really hot older guy and he was in like a bunch of stuff? I was like, no, that's just the jackass that played Flash Thompson. He's nobody. And she looks it up. I'm like, he was Deathstroke.
I know. He's like the hottest daddy in the world now, and a mega movie star. And he was his the childhood. But he's, you know, look for at Harry Osborn's funeral in Spider-Man 3. Blink and you miss it. He is there, like just as a That's background awesome. Extra. It's so funny. Cool. Yeah. No, the bullying is different now too than 20 years ago. Like in the first Spider-Man movie. It just seemed normal to me. Like, well, yeah, Flash bullies Peter, like how you bully normal, that happens. But like, just portrayals of bullying in TV is so different now that they don't.
They
don't want to just show like, well, yeah, and Peter gets like the crap kicked out of him and they break his glasses. Like, that's you know, they just don't do that anymore.
No, it's more like it would have to be a lot of online harassment and like on Twitter and stuff.
Which that's what Flash does. Flash in Homecoming, that Flash makes fun of him on like. You know, Instagram Live. He's like, look at Peter Parker. Bleh, this guy sucks.
More like Peter Dickhead. Like,
exactly. Yes.
Even accounting for the Mimi jokes in No Way Home that, you know, I still really enjoyed. Like, I watched Far From Home, I don't know, a couple months ago, like back in the summer, just when it was on Netflix again. And I don't think there's any joke that's as subtle or, you know, fairly subtle for you seeing flashes texts on his phone when Peter has the drone, and it's just him asking his parents where are they and that he misses them. Yes. And they just don't reply to him.
I did. Yeah. That's good.
That's what makes that bully fine.
Yes. Because
you never got that with original Raimi Flash. He's just some musclehead, and like that's all he'll ever be. But like this new Flash, even though he's very different from classic Flash, it's just he still has way more going on, which is amazing to say.
Yeah, I love him cashing in and saying I'm Spider-Man's best friend, and just yeah, that
dying his hair blonde.
There's so much good, and I also love that they have a Betty Brant in it who like both is accurately a high school student, but also has bits like she works for the Daily Bugle in the movie. Like, I mean,
yeah.
Oh yeah, we didn't even talk about how great like. Just he's back. J. Jonah Jameson's back. Like I think in the movie he says, he doesn't say pictures, but he says like, I need footage of Spider-Man. Like
footage. Yes. Exactly. That's the key difference, because he owns like a, you know, podcast / like online media empire. So that does make sense. And like, yeah, is he there doing anything really different? Is he important at all? No, but that's exactly what he should be.
Yeah, it's I mean, they got talk about cheap pops at the end of Far From Home. That was like such a cheap pop, and they're like, oh, let's give that. He just is Alex Jones, like, is so perfect. Like, he's even selling the nootropic supplements. Like, I
yeah,
it's so good.
It's the only way they could really bring back that character. I mean, like, I think in the comics over the years, like, yeah, they tried to make, you know, the Bugle was like an online website at some point and blah blah blah. So they have tried to update over the years, but like I think almost no actor in Hollywood was like, yeah, I want that role. Like,
yes.
No one is too intimidated. Like, there'd be more people that are like, oh yeah, I could be Spider-Man, no problem. But no one would want to be Jonah after J.K. Simmons.
No, yeah. As long as Simmons wants the role, he should be doing it. No, I guess the last thing we haven't really talked about is the death of Aunt May. So that was a shocker, you know? That did surprise me. I could definitely tell in interviews that Marissa Tomei was kind of tired of doing the role. I think she seemed kind of like done with it, but I still couldn't believe when she was escaping, I didn't think that Aunt May was in any danger. Oh, and so when the glider hit her, I was like, wow, they're doing this. They actually are killing off Aunt May and they did just do it in the video game, but so it's not like it's never happened in a mainstream thing, but it was quite a surprise. And she also got to do the full with great power there must also come great responsibility line.
I like that, giving that to her, because it seems like Ben never did, but this Peter's Ben never did, you know, never really goes into it, but you know, I like to think maybe it's something Ben said and she also, you know, picked up on it. It's like a saying that they both had, who knows. But I was at first the way they handled that was like, oh, she got knocked down, she's like, oh, I'm fine, and I did legit, you know, for that 5 minutes go, oh yeah, I guess, you know, she's gonna be hurt a little bit, she's out of commission, it'll upset Peter a little bit. So when they actually did do that, I was like, oh shit, okay. I think ultimately it's a good move, because if you still had the normal ending that's in No Way From Home, or, you know, there's a reset and he gets his own apartment, like he's still be going back to Queens. May will still be, oh no, Peter, oh, like, you know, like, it's not, I'm really glad she was there for what she did, and I like Marissa Tomei. I never really, you know, I still don't understand why she was casted, just so that we want
to have a hot Aunt May. That's all it was about. Like, well, how do we make this Aunt May different? Well, everybody, she will be a very attractive person, and everyone will say every scene, man, look at your aunt, she is hot. Like, yeah.
And there's only so much you can do of that, of so many movies. And I think also not having that comfort there for Peter, like when he's already dealing with something, like it'll negate a little bit of the, you know, fresh slate, you know, slightly back to basics, and, you know, not have that comfort zone there. I think ultimately it's interesting going forward. Like, she's in there for three movies, technically more, I think. If I don't remember if she had like a little cameo or whatever in the Avengers movies.
She's definitely in Civil War. I don't recall her in the other two though. Yeah.
Oh, she was at the funeral.
Oh, she was at the funeral. That's right. Yeah, yeah. Okay.
But yeah, no, I think that was a good choice overall. Like it's more interesting to me that way, honestly.
Yeah. Yeah. I think it gives him a different, like, it also makes his choice, you know, easier. I don't think at the end he would have decided to be erased if, like, oh, even Aunt May forgets me. I can't deal with that. Like, but it's once she's gone, and also she does get to tell him, like, well, no, you don't kill people. You don't leave people to die. Like, you help people. That's what we do. Like, that, it's a good driving force for Spider-Man. Yeah. I mean, to wrap it up for myself, I think that was a really good Spider-Man movie that, like, you know, addressed 20 years of watching Spider-Man movies. Like, my entire childhood was at, like, age 8, I get into Spider-Man. I'm reading Spider-Man comics for most of my life. And for the entirety of the 90s, I keep hearing a Spider-Man movie is about to happen. It's going to happen. Doesn't happen till 2002. And and so, like, my whole life has been about Spider-Man movies. And so, like, I don't want to say this is, like, closure, but it is quite a finale to an era of Spider-Man movies that is just, like, all live-action Spider-Man movies matter the same and all get to meet up in one movie. And
as exactly, matter the same. They're not swept under the rug like an embarrassing, like, thing that the movie studios, Marvel, you know, the owners of the character, like, feel like, well, let's not talk about that. So it's doubly amazing, especially in media today, where lots of things are, like, rebooted and never talked about again, like, oh, those characters are dead or that never happened. And it's really rare where things will come together in a way like this and be like, well, let's talk about these things. Let's bring some of this stuff back, even though some of it's not good stuff, you know. Mm-hmm.
All the stuff that wasn't good from mostly other the Amazing movies, but, you know, they addressed a little bit of, like, Sandman being boring. They improved it, especially Electro. Like, they did fix stuff that, like, oh yeah, that was a problem with Amazing. Well, hey, we fixed it. Like, now, don't you, I do wonder if, like, my executive, the, like, oh, I try to think like an executive kind of moment. I wonder if now executives are thinking, like, do you think we could just do another Amazing movie? Like, let's just do that and have it set in that universe and pick back up with Andrew Garfield.
I've seen people saying, it's like, well, if Sam Raimi is back directing, like, a Doctor Strange movie from Marvel, is obviously, you know, like, you're ready to take that, you know, huge amount of work again, and this worked really well, we could do that. They could be brought back for, you know, a movie way, way down the line when they're, like, in their 50s, I guess.
Yeah.
But I guess we'll see what happens with other stuff, like, that we're already flirting with this idea, like that new Flash movie is supposed to have Michael Keaton as Batman in there. It could become a more common thing to be like, well, why don't we, companies like this always start to second guess things like that. Well, we don't want to have brand confusion.
Sure.
You know, unless you have your Spider-Verse that's very clearly on the tin, says this is what this is. You're going to get a whole bunch of Spider-Men. If we were to, like, rank things, I think, like, I don't know, between all the Raimi movies and whatever, it's been a long time since I've watched Spider-Man 3 specifically, but sometimes I think that movie is so insane and has is so badly weird and weirdly bad that I might actually prefer it above movies that technically are better. But, like, top is, like, Spider-Verse still, to me, by, like, you know, considerable margin. I would put this at, like, a second or third and throw, like, a Raimi movie one or two in there, and then after that I don't really know where it breaks down. But it did make me have a new appreciation for Andrew Garfield specifically, because I think he was a bit of a standout in here, and how funny he was, just comedic timing and stuff. So it has been a long time since I've watched either Amazing thing, so I'd like to watch them again just to reevaluate them.
They're still not good, but he's good. On ranking two, I agree with you. Spider-Verse is still my favorite Spider-Man film. I think it is, like, the Spider-Maniest film ever. Not just that it has the most people who are spider-powered, but also it is so much about everything in Spider-Man history. And because it's in animation, it can do things that technically live action, though this film is full of CGI, but a live action film can't do the same. Second for me, this is third, because second for me still is Spider-Man 2. I know you felt it was overkill. I want to see Peter Parker suffer all of the time. That's my favorite Peter Parker, is a Peter Parker like going through hell and being like smacked in the head with a backpack as he's trying, like, oh man, I dropped my quarter. Ow, somebody hit me with another person. Like, I know it is, they do hurt him too much and his life is made too miserable, but that is kind of, that's kind of what I love about that movie. But
no, I get you.
But also, like, Evil Dead 2 is my favorite Evil Dead movie because Ash also is tortured the entire time. Like, Sam, this is, listen to the commentary on Spider-Man 2 if you want to hear Toby, and it's just Toby and Raimi talking about, like, oh yeah, you tortured me on this movie. Like, you kept hitting me in the head with backpacks over and over again. And he said that Toby on the commentary says Bruce Campbell warned him. He's like, oh yeah, Sam Raimi is going to torture you. That's what he did to me, but you'll end up with a great film.
At the very least. And yeah. It would be cool to, like, just see Raimi, like, not all the time, doesn't have to do big tentpole things, but hopefully Doctor Strange 2, like, does, you know, live up. Like, it's not like it has to live up, but it can also live down Doctor Strange 1, because that is, like, yeah, one of the more forgettable, like, MCU movies to me. Yeah. But I'd really like to think he'll bring a certain something to it, so I am looking forward to that as well.
Yeah, you know, that little bit of footage was interesting at the end of the trailers. Yeah, I'm looking forward to it. I guess, oh god, I meant to say this too. There was the weirdest credit at the end of the movie that it felt like they were forced to do by a lawsuit or threatening or like a cease and desist letter. It's so this is the credit that appears, like, after, I believe, the full cast in like after the post credit scene. It says, the filmmakers would like to gratefully acknowledge the original true believer, Avi Arad, whose vision led the way to bringing these iconic characters to the screen. Which, it's like, that really made me go, like, what the heck? Like, because he's not dead. He's still alive and I believe still working on movies. And I wonder if it's just like, I feel like I've always heard that Kevin Feige and him did not get along, and I wonder if Feige's rule on, like, if you want me working on Spider-Man movies, Arad has to go. And then Arad's like, well, you better at least thank me at the end of this movie if I don't get to be an executive producer on it. But,
like, you can't actually have any decision making with these films because, you know, for whatever reason we don't get along, or you produced a lot of garbage. Mm-hmm. Also throughout the 2000s, like, you know, for every, you know, Spider-Man 1 or 2, there's like a, you know, an Elektra.
Yes. He made a lot of crap, or he'll just say, like, oh, I'm totally making a Metal Gear Solid movie. Like, yeah, we'll see about that.
But he's the Revolver Ocelot, or he's always making threats. It's like, okay, we'll see. I was told this too, that credit was there, and I did not see it. I did not notice it, but that is really odd, because why in this one, why not in any of the others? It does seem strange, like there's something legally going on there.
Yeah, I mean, that thank you, I guess, you know, is deserved because this trades on all of the stuff that happened in films he was a big creative force on, for better or worse. Sure. You know, so I could see that, but it has the wording of, my lawyer specifically says put this in the movie, like, just it. I don't know, I the second I saw it, I was like, there's got to be some story behind this that we'll someday hope to get to know.
Hopefully.
But I guess, yeah, we've now gassed on about Spidey for almost 90 minutes now, so I don't want to keep you any longer, Matt. I mean, folks should check out all the cool, if you're hearing this on our Talking Simpsons stuff, everybody should check out all the great stuff Matt does. I mean, you just did a great Spider-Man 3 video about what happened to that.
Everyone, like, you know, Spider-Man movie comes out, everyone's trying to sync the content around the launch of that. But yeah, I know I did a little deep dive on Spider-Man 3, even a few things I didn't know that there was a editor's cut of Spider-Man 3 that does a few things and adds little things. So that was a new bit of information I found there. It was like back in 2017 they released that. So yeah, I did that. But you know, thanks so much for asking me on this. I was chomping at the bit to, like, talk about this, because I'm looking around too. Like, my wife's like, okay, I've heard enough of you talking about Spider-Man. You mumbled Spider-Man in your dreams last night, so I'm good. So yeah, I was looking for someone to talk to, and I can't think of anyone better than you. So thank you again for having me.
No, thank you. And also, I love your also on your YouTube channel, the recurring mediocre Spider-Man. I love those so much. Like, you play even the Spider-Man games that I was like, well, I'm not touching that. In my youth, I was like, I think I'm good. I don't need to play that Spider-Man game.
Yeah, no, that's really fun, just because there's still, like, you know, like, still a lot of obscure Spider-Man games. Like, there's one that was released only in Japan on the Super Nintendo that's actually, like, quite good. And then there was the point and click PC one based on the Sinister Six. Yeah. So there's lots of fun stuff there.
Yeah, I think that's Super NES one. I never played it, but I remembered it had, like, oh, it's got like a Mark Bagley cover. Like, they just hired Mark Bagley to do the cover.
Lethal Foes of Spider-Man, I believe.
Right. Ah, man. Everybody should check that out. And I'm at HENERYG on Twitter. You should know that now. And if you liked all of this talk, also, you know, you should listen back to, we did several What a Cartoon podcasts, me and Bob, with Matt, talking about Mortal Kombat, the X-Men 92 series, and
we did a Spider-Man episode too, I believe.
Yeah, we did Spider-Man and His Amazing Friends about Video Man, that classic. and also multiple episodes of Talking Simpsons. So yeah, everybody should check those out. And this is supported on Patreon at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons. Check out all the cool stuff we have there. If you liked all this comic book stuff as well, we just did an entire miniseries of our 10 favorite episodes of Batman the Animated Series. That was a whole lot of fun. You should check out those there. But okay, and until next Spider-Man movie, Excelsior! Excelsior!